Lee is joining us from Bell Direct. Julia, welcome to the program. Great to have you here. When it comes to Qantas, I think, you know, what stood out to me is that if it's a company that's willing to invest in more Dreamliners, it's a company that sees a bright future ahead, really.
Absolutely. When I think of turnarounds on the Australian share market in the last decade, I think the two standouts for me are Qantas and BlueScope. Remember, Qantas back in 2013 was a stock at 95 cents, and today we saw it finishing at $6.27. A big part of that turnaround and a big part of that story has been the oil price journey. And if we have a look at where oil prices have come from, back in 2013, we saw oil prices hitting a high around about $112 a barrel. And then, of course, in 2016, we saw oil prices reaching a low of $29 a barrel. So, of course, that sort of scenario really helped the turnaround in Qantas. But since then, I guess the big question is whether we could still see Qantas thriving, even though oil prices were on the way back up. And, of course, this is one of the biggest costs for Qantas. Back in February, we heard that they'd already hedged 50% of fuel costs for the next financial year. And look, today we heard that that hedging is now up to 70%. So you have to hand it to Qantas. They're really good at timing the oil market. And at a time when oil prices are climbing, they've managed to hedge away most of the effects of that rising oil price for the next financial year. So I think a huge plus there. Also, if we have a look at what's happening in the domestic market, it's very different from when Ansett was around. What we are seeing is capacity discipline and also rational pricing, and I think that's a plus not only for Qantas but also Virgin in this market as well. So altogether, we did see profit guidance being increased. The consensus was at about $1.55 billion for profit before tax, and the range is $1.55 to $1.6 billion. So Qantas on a tear today and doing really well on the back of that update.
Dancing around today, Julia, JB Hi-Fi. So you don't want a retailer in this environment to come out and essentially downgrade its outlook going forward. I mean, it's just, you know, poison pill. How serious do you think is the situation for JB, considering there are also other entrants into the market?
Naveen, I think JB Hi-Fi has peaked. All the signals have been there since the softer outlook statement they gave back in August last year. And since then, you know, back then, underlying consensus was around $242 million. Next, their guidance was cut to $235 to $240 million. And today, you know, another cut, $230 million. So we know that once this cycle starts, it does tend to take hold, and I guess a bit of that pessimism continues for a lot longer than what investors think might occur. So I guess in terms of JB Hi-Fi, there's a number of things that we're watching. This was the typical growth stock on the market. When you're looking at a growth stock in retail, this is all about trying to get new stores open and more sales in through the door. But JB Hi-Fi has spent a lot of money on that Good Guys acquisition, and that integration looks to be taking longer than expected, and it looks like new stores are on hold. So that growth story that's been underpinning JB Hi-Fi is on hold for the time being, and we continue to be disappointed by the guidance that we see from JB Hi-Fi. Now, it does also come at a time when competition is ramping up. Now, Amazon did have quite a soft launch here in Australia, but if you have a look at what Amazon has done in other countries, it ramps up pretty quickly, not only in terms of the range of products, but also in terms of price competition. So I'm guessing we're going to continue to see deflation being a factor in this space at a time when JB Hi-Fi looks like it is struggling with that Good Guys integration. If we have a look at the start of the financial year for JB Hi-Fi, the Good Guys, they saw like-for-like sales up by 5.7% in July. Here we are in Q3, and like-for-like sales are down 2.9% on a comparable basis. So altogether, I think a bit disappointing and really pointing to that cycle having peaked last year.
Kogan.com up by 5% today to $8.15. Julia, we've got a big day tomorrow again when it comes to the banks. This time it is the NAB. Business banking often a focus for NAB. I mean, what are you going to be watching for other than those sort of top line figures, obviously?
Look, I think this is going to be the messiest result out of the three big banks that we're going to see reporting. Look, In terms of consensus, it's a little bit hard to gauge this one because there's going to be a little bit of noise around this result. Nadine, as you mentioned, when you think of NAB, it's the most exposed to the business banking side. And if we have a look back to the first quarter update that we saw from NAB, the revenue trends were a little bit soft here. So the risk for me is that the revenue will once again miss expectations and that perhaps that trend continued into the second quarter. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like that's going to be offset by disciplining costs, because we know that the cost guidance is 5 to 8% growth. Now that's a pretty big range, but really not expecting to see a huge offset from the cost side. And in terms of the noise, well, last November we know that NAB said that they're planning to spend about $1.5 billion in terms of investment spending, and we also know there's restructuring costs of about $500 million to about $800 million, which will probably be booked in the half as well. And if you have a look at all the big four banks, I guess NAB's the most limited in terms of possible capital return opportunities, and that's because of where it stands in its Tier 1 equity ratio. So altogether, I think if you look at the banks, my preference at the moment would be Westpac, and the reason for that is because the March APRA numbers, the latest numbers, show that Westpac had the strongest lending growth out of the big four banks, and of course Westpac comes out with its result on Monday as well. So look, I think tomorrow it's going to be a bit of a messy one. It's going to take a bit of time to absorb, given some of the noise that will be around in these numbers. But look, I think NAB has the highest potential to disappoint out of the three banks that report this reporting season.
Okay, well, we will be watching every move the market makes when it comes to NAB, and plenty more besides tomorrow. Julia, thank you so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.